Day 3 of our travels in the Make a Good Level complex. Supplies are running low, but we still have potatoes and cabbages and various miscellaneous knickknacks. And we've made good progress, we've come so far, and yet there's still so far to go. 5 entries down, 4 remain. Who knows how long we will survive. Alright, next entry is Halloween 2021. I don't know what to expect, but I guess we'll see. Missed an S there, but that's alright. For absolutely no reason at all, I choose to believe that we are attending a fundraising event. You know, maybe the kids need a new, sink. I don't know. Oh. I guess that's some original art. Nice. Is this a whole level? Oh. You might need to get somebody to look at the floor here. I think we could use a little bit more of it. Alright. Okay, character. Right, it's a pumpkin smash event. How could I forget? Aha! Well, what if we smash all of them? As soon as you retreat, huh? Well, what if I don't retreat? Take that. Alright, I can see where this could go places. Aha, yeah, now we've got the mimics. Alright. Okay, probably want to give ourselves as much room to maneuver as we can. Perhaps the pumpkins themselves, well, I mean, they're just pumpkins. I don't know why I was afraid they were going to attack me like, water skippers would, but they're just pumpkins. I mean, they're pumpkins as large as a person. You know, they get pretty big sometimes, but, otherwise there's just nothing to write home about. We'll do it like this so that I can realign like that. So this mimic was still aligned with me, and this one I kind of brought into alignment. There we go. You know, why spend, 15 minutes fiddling around with mimics when we can just place them where they need to be to begin with? Okay, now things are... Okay, let's see, So I'm free, like, as long as I, stay within this area, I guess it's fine. I guess that's what this room's trying to teach me. If I do that, that's all well and good. I can have this keg help me out in this big area. So as long as we're in this big rectangle, then we're fine. Clear. Okay, fair enough. Okay. I like this. This is pitched at a nice low level of difficulty, but we are steadily upping the ante. We are making things a little bit trickier. It might actually be possible. Probably not with that golem the way it is. I was wondering if I could get this room done without the, without using the stick, but I think with this in the corner and that in the corner, I think it's not happening. And there's no scroll saying, not to do it, so, could push the, oh. I see. Well, I can do that. Well, okay, that doesn't really get us anywhere, but let's keep this in mind for later. Clear. Okay, now, we can close that door as long as something's weighing it down. Interesting. Okay. Now, how much reach do we get? Yeah, like, we can generate as many pumpkins as we want. Like, as long as we're not, stepping out of our relative areas, then we won't get another pumpkin spawning here. But, Yeah, I guess as long as we're blocking all the origin points, then it's okay if we have a pumpkin weigh this down. Like, for example, this one is over here. This might be checking specifically for a pumpkin still at this spot, or I think it maybe just generates a pumpkin regardless of whether where the original one is, I think. Yeah, if I leave that in there and then I leave, then it spawns another one. So it's more, it doesn't care whether there's already a pumpkin in there, it's just actually just looking out for bee throw in here. Or potentially a decoy. Let's see how that plays out. Okay, yeah, it's specifically bee throw. Doesn't care if there's already a decoy in here. Okay, so with that in mind, I guess what we want to do is something like this. Put that there. Don't care about that next one respawning. Then we just go ahead and kill this one. Now we can... No, we don't kill that yet. Okay. We can kill that, and maybe if we step diagonally here and we kill that one as our last action, then we're fine. Yeah, because the brain says that the turn that we do that. So, and we didn't get a pumpkin right here, didn't get a pumpkin right here. So I think that's it. Okay. Another excellent principle to keep in mind. I guess this is just going to be a big loop. I mean, we'll find out. This could just easily dead-end. I don't know why it would. That'd be very non-aesthetic, but it could happen. Alright. So as we saw in, this room, you need the 2x2 square in order to, get a keg onto, back onto where that is. But obviously that's not gonna stay there real long. So there's three of these. And we can light the fuse at either of these ends as appropriate. The X marks the spot suggests that we want to light this one, but maybe we want to light this one. So we could blow up one of these with three kegs. We could blow up one remotely. And as long as we time that with this dying, then we would be fine. Because spikes go off even after all NPCs move, so theoretically, as long as I do this right, with the right timing, let's see what that looks like. Just to make things, clear, I'm gonna light this on turn 10. Multiple of 5, that'll make it easier to count. Alright, so we wanted to blow up one turn faster, so I wanted to light it, one turn later. So light on turn 11. No. We want them to blow up on this turn, so actually we need to light it two turns sooner. I went in the wrong direction. So light it on turn, 9. We'll just kill that now. Okay, so that blows up, that got killed, and I think both of those events happened after NPCs would have done anything, so I think we're fine. Okay. That's delving a little bit more deeper into DROD scripting and order of events within a turn, but it's still pretty well within, mostly standard, tricks. Okay, now what? Well, I suppose, this is the first time we've... No, it's not the first time we saw monsters, other than, the pumpkins, but I suppose it's fine if the guards are alive as long as all the pumpkins are smashed. Alright, so we need to just gain some distance here, like so. And then we'll kind of draw you over this way. I'm gonna get around you. And then kind of draw you in like so. And this ought to work pretty well. Oops, not like that, though. There we go. So, critically, I'm making this move to make it rotate its sword, so that way it gets from the, like, the 4 distance to the 5 distance away, and that's what lets me actually make one more step in order to get out of its radius. Alright, so that, as expected, brain goes away, now I can kill the guards. Alright, I'm getting to be a pretty seasoned pumpkin smasher, if I do say so myself. Oh, this room's just silly. Alright, you're gonna be sick of pumpkin by the time you're done with this adder. I'll tell you that. Let's make our extra long adder. There's probably a way of optimizing this, but maybe get this thing to eat pumpkins real fast. But I'm just gonna kind of do it haphazardly. I think it's pretty clear what's going on here. Yeah, just still gonna need to make it a little longer, though. Yeah, there's probably a precise length of snake and snake movement that you can do to make this work out just right, so you don't have to make it super long. Oh, it's not spawning another one because I'm standing in there, that's why. But yeah, I think for the imprecise movements I'm doing here, I think I am going to have to make this at least a little ways longer. Probably long enough to complete that rectangle I was doing. Alright, that should be good. Yeah, that'll do. No matter how long I play the game, sometimes I still step adjacent to snake heads. It just happens. Oh, hello, friend. Hello, friend. There we go. Now we can actually move around this thing. So probably, all things being equal, I probably want the chain to cover, like, lead the head over this way. And you want the tail segments to kind of come in over here. And kind of cover things up like this. Yeah, that'll do. Ooh, close, but not quite. Yeah, maybe up like that. That'll give us more of a head start. Like that. There we go. That was just in the nick of time. If I hadn't stabbed that brain on my turn, then this pumpkin would have respawned, but we're fine. Okay. A little bit more technical than the others. Oh, well, never mind. This door was here. Okay, never mind. I thought I had two ways to go, but it was not the kind of loop I thought it was. I thought it was a double-ended loop, but it's a single-ended loop. One-way travel only. So, I can close these back off if I want. We can do some esoteric briar growing stuff if we do this kind of thing. Kind of grow it, okay, so fundamentally our problem is that, we don't want it to block off this entrance. We're fine if it blocks off that entrance, but if it kind of grows out here and covers that up, then we're just, not having a good time anymore. Yeah, this is a trick we've abused in some other holds in the past, in most recent living memory, I think it was, Don't Play This Dumb Hold by, Disoriented. I think I've got the details of that right. But lots of people have messed around with this in the past, including, Boy Blue. So, to explain what's going on here in a little bit more detail, there is an extremely weird quirk of briar growth, where, because I'm cutting this off from the root, when the root grows and kind of rejoins this patch, it's just gonna try and always expand it from the these live tiles here, this these black briar areas, rather than these red bits. So that's why I'm getting this irregular shape kind of progressing forward instead of a flat wave front. I don't think I've done it quite right, though, because I'm still getting, it's got to go over still pretty far in order to make it here. I think that one tile might be enough, though. We'll see. I'm basically waiting for this tile right here to turn gray. Yeah, it's also a little bit trial and error because when I step off the plate, the briar gets one more turn to mature and turn some of this red stuff black before the doors close. So it might be a little tiny bit more fair if I had an orb here, because another DROD order of events within a turn subtlety. If B-Throw goes ahead and hits an orb, then that orb closes the door immediately. As part of him hitting that orb. So that would mean that I would close the door and you would preserve the state of the briar as it is, as you see it, which would be a little bit kinder than this whole step off the plate and cut the briar off, resulting in a state one turn later than the state that you see when you make your action. So, subtle stuff, but still important to pay attention to. That's your job as an architect, is to pay attention to the most subtle aspects of, the elements you're working with. I don't have to do anything special here. I've already produced the result I want. Yeah, so, suffice to say, there are much scarier things in the world than whatever this brain is up to. The briar, I fear the briar more than I fear the pumpkins. Okay, well, that's this section. I guess this is one of those holds where, yeah, everything's gonna be in one level, but this was like a sub-level of the whole thing. So much for that section, then. Yes I am. You're gonna replay that cutscene every time I, enter this room, aren't you? So the candy exchange is to the north. What's to the west? Oh, back to the contest hub, of course. And, we were going to have a third event this year, but the organizer was sick, and so they couldn't make it, you know. These things happen. Huh. Oh, I see. Oh, of course. Yeah, you're holding one candies, and you're holding three nega candies, or anti-candies, or whatever. Everyone should have non-negative, so some people are allowed to have zero. Okay. That's fine. Yeah, so this is giving me very strong, disoriented vibes. Also, I can just, walk over here and, step on that conquer token myself. Presumably, I'm not supposed to do that. But I feel as though I should make people aware of that. So you're gonna follow me, huh? Oh, you give one to everyone else that you're linked to? Is that it? Okay, so share their candy with their neighbors. Well, this brings up an obvious question. What happens if, this person has two candies, but they have three neighbors. Then what? Oh, well, then they just give, yeah, exactly. They give three candies away, and then they have negative one. Of course. It's so simple. So there's probably, like, a formal way of, like, you can probably make, like, vector arithmetic out of this or something. I am not going to do such a thing. But we can. How am I gonna spread? Like, we need to do some wavefront spreading here, I think. yeah, that's going to just result in you getting more candy. So, like, yeah, bumping people who are already negative is not going to help resolve that. I can give extra candy to you. There's probably a way to generate infinite amounts of candy here, but you'd probably need, like, a very specific network topology in order to make that happen. So I'm not gonna worry about it too much. So yeah, this actually kind of reminds me of Lights Out of all things. I think there's probably a similar principle going on here where probably some moves you can make kind of cancel each other out. But it's all going to depend upon what your first moves are, in a manner of speaking. Just not quite sure to get the candies, like, I want to get this last unit of candy kind of out through the funnel. I guess, if I do this, we're close, but not quite. This makes no sense, so I'm going to try it anyway. That's kind of what you wind up reducing yourselves to sometimes. That seems to have brought us back to parity. I think I'm actually going to take a look at another room. That might actually be more helpful than fooling around with this some more. Okay, now, we can't skip this room. Okay. We could skip this one. Can't skip this one. Alright. Bit of an odd theme for this contest. I mean, it's a neat idea. I am questioning the, putting it in the exact same contest entry as, this other, which is a lot more DROD-like, of, a level. This kind of seems like two separate entries to me. I mean, they're thematically connected, but, they're just very different. And I guess that's maybe the point, is so that if you got stuck on one of these, you could go back and try the other one. But, yeah, it does kind of still feel separate, in a manner of speaking. Wait. Okay, yeah, that's correct. Just updated before the candy got there. But that's fine. Yeah, so I'm not sure what an end state for this looks like. I think it's actually a bad idea to collect all your negativity in one area. Because the nature of these operations is always to spread out candy rather than to send it to one specific area. So, it seems like working backwards, the only way you're ever going to actually solve this puzzle is if you have, like, negative one on... Like, yeah, a situation like this where it's negative one, and two over here. That's kind of the end state we're looking for. I should probably be more rigorously mathematically analyzing this, but I'm afraid I'm making a Let's Play video for the internet, so it's a little bit harder for me to do that. I did not come prepared for this degree of mathematical frippery, for lack of a better word. I think leaving negative ones behind me is helpful, because now I've managed to do this. So now I've gotten a one over here and a one down there, and that probably helps. So now I can kind of leave my negative one over here and then kind of carry it with me. Well, now I've produced a negative two. I'm not so happy about that. Let's back that up then. Maybe this is what we want. We'll still wind up with a negative two, but it's adjacent to two other big positives. Maybe that helps. Yeah, so we can kind of reset it like that. Do that. And I think we've actually got it now, because now we're splitting this into three, and we're going to solve all both of these at once. Huh. Okay, well, that was obviously just a lot of fiddling around. I didn't formally work through this or anything, but that at least gives me a little bit more insight as to how this works, I think. So I think it's actually a bad idea to wind up with negative ones over there. Like I said, I think it is a good idea if both of your negative ones are, well, yeah, you need negative ones in order to be all adjacent to one node. Almost by definition. Yeah, you have to take care of them at the end. Huh. No, that's a really suspicious looking ghost over there. I'm not. Well, I am sort of interested in how this develops. I mean, now we're seeing the starting state with a negative four and even more complicated graphs. I guess this is everything that we're seeing here. Cause yeah, well, this is just gonna be another puzzle. There's a roach. Character Roach. Hello, friend. Yeah, it's some nice art. I guess it's just a regular old connection this way. Yeah, well, these are all planar graphs. Yeah, planar graphs. I haven't seen any crossovers on any of them. Obviously, some of the paths are a little bit convoluted, but, still works. Huh. Well, at least there's no opportunity for secrets here, at least via regular exits. I don't see any sneaky, like, I don't think I see any image floor masquerading as an obstacle here. I think this is exactly what it looks like. Huh. Well, I'm not sure how I want to handle this one. Do I just sit down and math this out on camera, or do I just kind of do this off camera and then come back with some results and then speed through this? Can we at least, I'll try and at least solve one more on camera. I think that's a fair compromise. It's just very much not what I was expecting, that's all. Okay, so so I think it's pretty clear in this case that because our positive candies and our negative candies add up to one net candy, and the maximum degree I see at any vertex here is three, that we're going to wind up with a situation where I think we do want three candies at one of these center nodes, and then we're going to distribute like one to a negative one over here and one to a negative one over here. And that ought to balance things out. So I guess we'll just try and play with that in mind. I don't know how I'm still not sure how to navigate between my states all that well. But I can at least give it a try. So, okay, so actually, this does help actually clarify things. So, either we can have a 2 over here, like somehow this is 0, this is 0, this is 2, then activating a 2 here will work, because this will go from 0 to 1, and this will go from negative 1 to 0. That's one potential solution. The other would be, you put 1 over here, and then you put another one over here. So you would turn into a negative one, you would be a three, and then we would have a situation where there's a three and there's a negative one, a zero, and a negative one surrounding it. And that would solve the problems. Yeah, so what happens if I do that? Okay, negative two, as I expected. And if you give yours away, you become negative one and negative one. Okay, that's actually good. Yeah, that's what we want. Sort of. That's close, but not quite right. This is fine, right? This turns into, well, it turns into negative two. Hmm. Yeah, that's not quite right. We're close, though. I feel like we're close, but there's just something I'm still not quite getting about the way this network works here. Like, I keep imagining that I can transfer individual candies, but that's definitely not how this works. It just seems to be awkward to turn a negative 2 into a negative 1, because, yeah, I got rid of that negative 1, but here's this negative 2 again. So, I think that means I need to come back here and do some more nonsense with cleaning this up. Alright, that looks better. So now I've actually produced a 4 over here, but now I'm gonna do this, and I'm still gonna have a 1 left over, and I'm right back where I started. Hmm. Darn anti-candy. Now, there is actually a good model for this all working out. Because everything is related to addition and subtraction, and you're only going into temporary debt, another way I guess you could think about this, if the concept of anti-candy bothers you, is you can pretend that this is like a quota level, and like everybody is starting with like 30 candy or something. And zero means they have 30 candy and they would like to have 30 candy. And the goal is to redistribute the candy using the exact same rules in such a way that everybody has at least 30 candy. So this would be 31, this would be 31, this would be 29. And so in that way, at least it's okay if individual people temporarily go into debt as long as it gets reserved later, and you never have any individual person go below 30 pieces of candy. I don't think that's necessarily actually a helpful way of thinking about it, but it's fun. It's a nice tangent. Huh. Alright, you know, this is actually a nice place to stop and take a break on that note. I'm gonna have to actually think about what I want to do here, because, well, I already said it, but, well, fine, I'll go out and say it anyway, for the sake of a bad pun, if nothing else. I'm nonplussed.